Are you working? What kind of work do you do?
So today we are joined by some very special guests. It's funny, in my notes, I have you guys written down as the Stockade Boys, but it sounds way too much like a country western band. So we'll meet them. We'll meet them individually. We have Dennis Crowley, who is the co-founder of Dodgeball, co-founder and executive chairman of FOURSQUARE, and the founder and chairman of Stockade. And then we also have Dan Hoffay, who is the technical director of Stockade and the assistant coach at SUNY Ulster Men's Soccer, if something hasn't changed that I'm unaware of. Okay. And also a fourth grade teacher, which if it hasn't changed. All right, Okay. Cool. So amazing, guys. So great to have you. Welcome to Footwork.
Thanks for having us on the show.
Yeah, thank you so much. Looking forward to it.
Of course. So in our early episodes, when we had New York guests, we kind of asked them this question. So as guys that spend a lot of time in the Hudson Valley, Kingston area, we need to know where does upstate New York begin?
I feel like Dennis and I are going to have very, very different answers to this.
This is perfect.
Amazing.
So my answer as a Hudson Valley born and bred is upstate New York starts above Albany. Anywhere where that big long piece of Western New York hits Central New York. Yeah. Anything above that is upstate New York. Below that, below the capital region, Kingston, Poughkeepsie, Westchester, White Plains, down into the city is all, I consider that downstate, and then there's the city.
Mm-hmm. See, that's what I like to hear.
Nobody ever says downstate, though. Like, that's not a word that people use.
No, it's not, unfortunately.
I went to Syracuse, so I went to school upstate, right? So I totally get the above Albany thing. But as someone that lives in New York City or spends half my time in the city, like anything, like it's New York City, Westchester, anything north of Westchester is upstate. So I'm
in concurrence with Dennis here.
Yeah, I was under the impression that anybody from New York City thought that like anything north of them, even in the city, like one street north of them was upstate.
Yeah, I've heard Yonkers before is upstate, so
There you go, the Bronx.
Yeah. All right, well, two very different answers too, but I think I'm with Dan and Sean's with Dennis on this, but it's okay. So
50-50.
Sean, are you a New York City kid?
Long Island. Grew up in Long Island.
Even worse.
Yeah.
Even worse. It's called Eastern New York.
Yeah.
Eastern New York.
The far east side.
The far east. Yeah.
Far east. All right. So enough upstate talk. I mean, I guess it's going to come back into upstate depending on the definition. But, I mean, you guys started Kingston Stockade. You guys started a club. So we have to first start off with, how did the idea come about? How was that born?
Yeah, so, I was playing five-a-side games in, just pickup leagues in New York. And then one day after one of our games, had beers with my buddies, and we were thinking, how do we take our club and actually get it to the point where it would play against the Red Bull someday? And it was just like a thought exercise, right? What have to happen for us to like qualify for the US Open Cup so we could then do that, right? And just thinking about that, and no one knew the answer, but then the next day it kind of went really deep on the Wikipedia rabbit hole and learned about all kind of the lower levels of soccer, which I really just didn't, I kind of knew were there but didn't really understand it. And that introduced me to clubs like Chattanooga and Detroit, who were in the MPSL. And as I started doing some research on those clubs, I was like, holy cow, these things are amazing. And then you kind of have this realization that like, these haven't been here for thousands of years. Someone just made these clubs. They just decided to invent them. And I kind of had a similar moment thinking, we should make one of these. Like, this would be an awesome thing to make. Like, where would you do it? Oh, I know, you do it up in Kingston, right? The moment you see Dietz Stadium and you understand it's like a kind of an underutilized piece of infrastructure for this. And so one of the very first things that I did, because like I knew people in the Hudson Valley, but I wasn't connected in any way to anything soccer related, is I went on Twitter and I found the American Outlaws supporters group in the Hudson Valley. And just, I remember I was in San Francisco for work at the time. And I think I had one too many beers one night. And I just sent a DM on Twitter to AL Hudson Valley. And I was like, I don't know who runs the account, but hello, what do you think about trying to do a soccer team in the Hudson Valley? Would people go? Would people care? Would people play? And I can't remember it was Dan or someone else replied back like an hour later. And that was it. That was the very beginning of it.
7 o'clock
in the morning. Yeah, I know, right? And then we went out. We kind of had this like awkward meet and greet taco dinner somewhere, and I don't remember where it was. And then from there, we just kind of started talking about it. And it I want to say it came together fast, but things started getting real quick. Mm-hmm.
Mm. Wow. So it's amazing to hear that this all was just born from a sliding in a DMs.
For real.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah. Dan, from your perspective though, is it like, you know, how did you just got a random DM one day over the moon?
When I was at school in Albany College, I got really involved in the American Outlaws. So it was fresh off of like the 2006 World Cup. I got really involved in AO Albany and was having a blast with guys up in Albany. And when I came home from school, it was like, we need to do something like this in the Hudson Valley. So a few buddies of mine, we started the American Outlaws Hudson Valley chapter. And, you know, we had like an awesome 2014 World Cup. There were like tons and tons and tons of people at the bar in Poughkeepsie, beer splattering all over the place when Jermaine Jones scores goals. Like it was wild. So yeah. We were fresh off that when it was, I think it was the summer 2015 when I like woke up going, it's getting ready to go to summer school in the morning. I was teaching summer school. I got up like 7 o'clock and I see this DM from some verified guy at like 4:25 in the morning or something. I'm like, what is this? So I'm texting my buddy Corey, who helps me with like some of the social media stuff on American Outlaws. And he's like looking him up and he's like, holy crap, this guy's pretty big time. Like, what is he doing? So we started exchanging messages and we went out to dinner one night. It was super awkward the first time, like Dennis said, but I actually had to leave my brother Nick's godson's birthday party to go meet Dennis for dinner to talk
priorities.
About the crazy idea. Exactly. It was, there was so much unknown.
Yeah. Yeah.
There. I mean, the next summer we were playing in the NPSL with you.
Yeah. I remember we went to that dinner. I don't remember where it was. It was like a horseshoe shaped booth, which is what makes it weird. Like anytime when someone wants to get out, like everyone.
Oh, it's the worst. Yeah. Yeah. 10 people have to get out. Yeah.
It was, you know, my wife and I were just at the house when we can drive back to the city. And so she came with us. And then we, you know, we had like another 45 minute drive. And just like, well, what do you think? What do you think of these guys? And I'm like, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know if they know what they're doing. But like, let's just try it.
Yeah,
we'll figure it out as we go.
Just rolled with it. Yeah.
It really does sound like the beginning of any true, you know, great love story. It's just it has really all the factions there. What were what were some of the biggest hurdles? Like, I mean, it was a very quick transition from that awkward dinner date to launching, you know, in the NPSL with a full team, coach, all of these things. So what were some of like the initial hurdles and some of the unforeseen challenges that you guys saw?
Yeah, it's a lot of work, right? And the thing is, you know, going into it, I don't think we really knew how much work it was. Maybe Dan certainly knew from like the, you know, putting the, or had some sense from the putting the team together, you know, organizing, kind of getting a functional squad together point of view. I had never done anything like this in terms of like, I got to rent a stadium. We got to get a logo and a brand and insurance and coaching staff and tryouts and season tickets and merchandise. And, you know, like, you know, I remember naively thinking, making a list being like, well, there's probably like six things we got to do. Make some kits, get a stadium, and make some tickets, right? That's it. You start unpacking it. Like, actually, there's like 1,500 things to do. And, you know, like one of the, I think the big moments for the club and kind of like some of the stuff we stand for was like, I went on Google being like, okay, how do you start a soccer team from scratch? And there was nothing, and like, nothing under Google results. And we kind of made this decision, in addition to making the club, like, let's try to write about it as we do it to make it easier for the next person that comes along.
Right? Yeah.
And that has turned out to have been very influential. You know, I've talked to hundreds of clubs over the last 5 years that have seen those blog posts and said, this gave me just enough confidence to think I can do it. I have three more questions. And I'm like, all right, let's just get on the phone for 15 minutes and I'm happy to help. Right. And that's like I think that's like a core part of the club too.
Yeah. We have stuff from anything about finances of the club to how to put together the team, how to run a youth clinic to, you know, NCAA compliance. You know, there's so much information that we've put into these blog posts, including like raw real numbers.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember that post of the club's finances after the first year. And it's a great read for anyone.
Yeah. And we talked to people all over the world. I talked to a club, you know, it was like some 20 something kid trying to start a club like an hour outside of Rome, you know? And I was like, I don't know anything about the landscape over there in terms of soccer fans and villages and stuff, but I can walk you through the numbers. And of course, it's, you know, US dollars to the lira is a totally different thing, but it's like, just look at the percentages. You're going to spend 30% on this, 40% on this. So take your budget and that's what it's going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Vatican City FC.
No. Is that...
No.
Oh man, I wish I was gonna look up their merch right there away.
Now.
I wish, so, if anything, I wish I kept track of all the clubs that we talked to, so we could have like a alumni page of clubs that like we touched at some point. But it's probably been 100 clubs, 200 clubs.
Wow. You know?
It's and some of them may never get off the ground. It's just people like kicking the tires on. Is this something I want to do? Is this something I want to spend money on?
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, Dennis, I can't help but draw a tie between maybe you can give a little insight to everyone what Foursquare your company is. I mean, you've started this company, but I also saw a video from about 2 years ago where, so you just mentioned that, you know, let's start a club and let's write about it, that way we can help people in the future start a club.
Yeah.
But you also did a very similar thing with Foursquare. Now, I'm no computer science guy, but you basically, this programming that you guys created, you then allowed and gave it to other people to use for free up to a certain amount of people, but allow their creativity to take over. And I feel like it's almost exactly the same thing as what you're doing here. You guys did it. You made the club. You wrote about it. And it's kind of like a guideline for other people to then take off and do whatever they want with it.
Yeah, in a sense, right? So like Foursquare is, you know, 12 years old, right? I think it's 12, almost like this week is our 12th year anniversary.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, like we started off just making like one consumer app and, you know, people would check into places and games and city guides and stuff like that. And we got, you know, 50, 60 million people using it, which is a pretty good chunk. And then from there, you know, we launched other apps. We have advertising services and analytics services. And, you know, a big part of the business now is like building tools for other developers. So, you know, Twitter and Uber and Samsung and Apple, if they need to do stuff with location technology or location data, like a lot of times they come to us and we, you know, we do like a data partnership and they pay us for the services. But, you know, one of the things that we also do is we make those tools available to small developers. So if people want to come along and just like, hey, I'm a student at NYU and I want to use this technology, like we have all this documentation, not dissimilar from, you know, explaining on, you know, on Stockade, here's how you make it. And then we give away the stuff for free until you turn into a big company and then we charge you for it. So it's not totally dissimilar. You know, my own experience as, you know, founder of like, you know, two tech companies. And then, you know, I was CEO of Foursquare for 6-7 years. And then, you know, now I do a lot of, like, you know, angel investing and advising and stuff. Like, I try to make myself accessible for people that are going through the entrepreneurial journey, like stuck on fundraising or stuck on product development or stuck on, like, I've never managed people before. What do I do now that I have 200 people, right? So in the same way, I try to spend some of my time helping, you know, people build stuff in the soccer community. I spend another chunk of my time trying to help people build, like, startups and tech things and, you know, getting things off the ground, right? So it's really just, it's all the same stuff, right?
Right.
You have an idea for something you want to make, whether it's like writing code or bringing people together at a soccer match, you know, you make a list of the, you know, you foolishly make a list of the 5 things you think you have to do. It actually turns out there's 1,000 things you have to do. And you just, you know, you get enough people together that you work through the list of 1,000 things to do. It's the same process for anything, really. Right. And it's just a matter of taking a big project and breaking into smaller chunks and then trying to do, you know, a little bit of work every day so that, yeah, like, you're slowly making progress.
Mm-hmm. And in founding Stockade and founding a company like Foursquare, did you foresee, like, that there would be many parallels, or did you think that it was just kind of like the Wild West? And were you able to bring a lot of the stuff that you had formed in a tech company into forming Stockade?
Yeah, people ask all the time about, like, the overlap. Like, what does a Stockade have to do with a technology company? And, you know, to be honest, like, they're two totally different things, but, like, you know, at the root of it, it's just like you have an idea for something. It doesn't yet exist. You want it to exist. And so you make it exist. You just make the stuff, right? And it doesn't matter if you're, like, you're going to start a bakery or a coffee shop, a soccer team, or some tech company, or like a fashion label, or whatever. It's like you start from nothing and you just keep doing a little bit until you've got something, bring people in, and then you just keep building it all together. So that stuff is the same. You know, I think the thing that's kind of most, I think, is most interesting, because Foursquare now is a totally different company than it was when we started. Like, when we started, it was a consumer app, and it was about, you know, having this thing that brought people together. Like, Foursquare, the app, was about, like, getting people together to have good times at bars and restaurants and physical spaces. Like, how do you use technology to bring people together? And that's kind of what Stockade is. Like, Stockade is just, like, there's guys running around on the field scoring goals, and we're playing in this league, right? But it's like, you're bringing the community together. You're bringing 1,000 people from the community that may not know each other, right? Bringing them together to, like, cheer on the squad, cheer on the community. And that's really what it is. And so when I talk to other entrepreneurs outside of, you know, like, people doing soccer stuff, and get them to focus, like, listen, it's not just about the 90 minutes on the field. It's about the, like, how do you create an environment where, you know, fans want to come because this is the most fun that they can have in a 2-hour span, right? On the weekend. And
it is too.
They want to bring their family. They want to bring their kids, right? That's like it's just a different way of thinking about it, but it's an important way of thinking about it.
Mm. And just to bring personal experience from being a player and returning as a fan in the stands, I mean, both experiences, like, Stockade is, you know, I've been around the world, you know, and I've played in many different countries, and still, like, the experience I had at Stockade with the fans and the drums and the speakers and the chants was just like, you know, it's what you're chasing around the world. And it was so cool that this was in the Hudson Valley and was just accessible to, you know, players who wanted to chase this. So, I mean, hats off to you guys for that.
I wish I could say that was us, but, like, it's not, right? All we did was create, like, the platform. Like, we'll rent the stadium, we'll get a good team that you want to watch there, and we'll make it a fun environment. But I remember, like, you know, Kale Kapelschillen is this, one of the guys that I got connected to really early. Around the same time I got connected to Dan about putting the soccer side of Stockade together, I got connected with this guy named Kale, who was helping me on, like, the community side. Cause I was kind of new to Kingston. Like, we only had the house for a couple years. And Kale was like, oh, I know just the right people that you want. Like, oh, sometimes soccer games have drummers. Well, we have a whole like drumming group, right? That works with the high school, and they want to come to the games. Yeah. And they had, you know, never been to a game in Brazil and experienced this, you know, in person. And so the very first day they just did, the very first game, they got there and they just did like a drum beat, like kind of like this, not like a salsa drum beat, just like a kind of American drum beat
for
90 minutes. And it was awesome. It was like being at like
I can hear it right now.
Cool. I can hear it too, right? That's what makes it kind of awesome. And I remember they came up to me at the end and they're like, did we do it right? Like, I was like, I've never experienced anything like that. And it was awesome. It was awesome. You know, it was like, you know, like when you're playing like, you know, it was like the background music when you're playing Street Fighter, right? It's just like in the background, it's going and it's like keeping you going and keeping you going. And it gets faster and slower sometimes. Like that's what it was. And they just kind of organically nailed it. And then we've had, you know, the drummers do that, the supporters do that. Like people just come and they express themselves in different ways at the games. Mm-hmm. And it's just turned into something awesome.
And they sit right behind the away team's bench. So
amazing. Which is nice. Yeah, that is nice. Now, I mean, just to stay on this subject. So, sorry, go ahead.
We had one of the owners come up to me during mid-game, because I'm always like pacing back and forth on the track, watching the game. And one of the owners was like, you have to tell those drummers to quiet down. We cannot communicate with our players. I'm like, it's kind of the point, you know?
Hit the drums louder.
Guys, just turn it up like 100%.
Could you imagine like Roy Williams at Duke, and you know, playing at Duke, going over to Mike Krzyzewski and saying, can you get the Cameron Crazies to calm down a little bit so that I can communicate better with my players?
Just everyone quiet down. I have to do this. Yeah, like, no.
Hey, I got to yell to the guy on the other side of the court. Keep it down a little bit.
Exactly. Now to stay on this, it was one of the things that I think draws anyone to Stockade is this strong fan base. Now you've touched on some of the things that you guys have kind of laid down, but for both of you in terms of social media, providing things at the stadium, to the things that you do with the youth and the kids showing up in jerseys and getting in for free, like what are some of the things that you think are very important in creating a strong fan base?
I think that the transparency that our club has with the people is a major piece. Like we're open, we're honest. They know they know that it's real. Like we've been updating them on our 2021 season, you know, as much as we can, working on things. We're trying to get ready to play. But there's obstacles in the way, you know, like those open and honest conversations that we have with the community really keeps them intertwined into the soul of our team.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's just like having, I definitely see clubs, like small clubs that start and they try to feel bigger than they are. Like, oh, we have a front office and a president and such. And I always feel like we take the other approach. Like we go to Keegan's and we sell t-shirts out of a Tupperware container. And they're like, you're the chairman of the club. I'm like, yeah. And I'm also the chief t-shirt folder. That's how this operation is run.
I take both very seriously.
yeah, exactly. And I think people, you know, people can relate to it. Like they see that we're just trying to, you know, trying our best to put on like a good experience. And, and I think when that happens, you get people that want to contribute in all these interesting ways, right? So like, you know, whether it's the drummers coming out or a supporters group emerging, or, you know, people being like, hey, is it okay if we do a march from the match? Like, of course it is. Is it okay if we organize a supporters meetup and we stream the game at this bar? Yeah, just do whatever. Don't ask me permission. We just made the platform. You do whatever you want on top of it. And then I also think it's just like, you know, you kind of run the experience for the fans. Like the best version, the best kind of example I can tell you this about this is like, I think it was our very first game. I can't remember if it was a regular season game, if it was the first friendly that we ever played at Dietz, where we didn't know if we were going to have 50 people show up or what. and there was 800 fans in the crowd, right? And, you know, I remember just being so distracted by just like, we have a game, now there's people playing, okay, what's going on? The ref blows, 3 minutes in the game, the ref blows the whistle for something, and the crowd goes wild, and everyone turns around, and they're like, what? It's like, oh my God.
When did they get it? Yeah.
Right? It filled up so quick, you didn't even realize. But at the end of the game, like unexpectedly, just all the kids ran down to the fence, right?
Oh,
and they all wanted autographs. And like nobody expected that. Nobody knew what to do. You know, Jamal, who was the captain, you know, took everyone together and was like, all right, it's great. Look at this crowd came out to support us. Here's what we're doing. Nobody goes inside until every single kid gets something signed. And, you know, Jamal's like, Dennis, you got pens? I'm like, I have one in my pocket. I have a Sharpie in my car, right? So we had like three pens for 800 kids, and we just stayed outside for like an hour. And that is the essence of like what the club is, right?
Yeah.
It's like we are here to serve the community, inspire the kids, give people a good time, be role models, be something people can aspire to. And everyone on the, you know, on that side of the fence, on the player side of the fence, is willing to put in the time to do that. And that's what the club is.
And I think Dennis just kind of gave you a little glimpse into really what it takes on a day-to-day basis. Like he mentioned the pens. The pens are a running joke with us. Like we never have enough pens, never have enough markers. Like remember to bring the pens to tryouts, like stuff like that. But like game one, we had no idea what we needed. And we learned that game two, we needed like 35 Sharpie markers there with us. You know,
we're
constantly, and even still to this day, we're constantly learning. And that's the point of the transparency. That's the point of sharing with other clubs, is to really give them a little bit of a roadmap of the things that we're learning on the fly.
And I mean, it was such a cool, just cultural thing, like win, loss, draw, it didn't matter. Like grab a pen and go thank the little kids. And, you know, you try and spark up a conversation with them. Half the time they're way too nervous to say anything.
And
I'm like, you're not going to know my name. Like when you go home, you just see this Sharpie going on, like on your jersey or whatever. But yeah, I mean, it puts it in perspective, especially during a loss, when you would go over, sign a thing and just be like, you know, this is really cool. It's bigger than just this game. It's like
field matters.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Love that. I can't tell you how many like messages, emails, even like if I go to the supermarket and I wear a Stockade jacket, like parents will stop me and they'll be like, you know, thank you so much for bringing this to town. Like all my kids want to do is play soccer now. They're so inspired by it. All they want to do is kick a ball. I'm like, that's awesome. Right.
Yeah.
You know, we went to the coach of Kingston High School. And I was like, hey, did you see any noticeable uptick in the number of people that tried out for soccer? He's like, yeah, it was like twice as many.
Wow.
That's a cool data point. Thank you.
Yeah. I mean, just from personal experience growing up in the Hudson Valley in Monroe, like, I mean, the closest things we had were MLS teams in the city. So like, it was there, but it wasn't really tangible, you know, like these kids that can go and see something. Yeah, it's not, you know, first tier, but to them, it's still like, you know, it is. It's what they can see, and then it's what they can strive for. I think that's a very important thing for a kid to have, is some way of looking how to get there. And for most of us, it wasn't there, you know?
That's the essence of it, right? Like it doesn't have to be D1 top flight professional, right? In order for it to matter, right? And I think, you know, like we're running these surveys and people would say, yeah, Stockade is my favorite club. I'm like, it's your favorite, what, over like any club in the world? Yeah, it's my favorite club because it's the club in my town. And I was like, gosh, I just never, you never expected that to happen,
you know?
And then, you know, like a lot of people would argue, like we have people that travel from all over. We've had people drive like 12 hours to come see a Stockade game. It's like, why did you drive 12 hours? You know, because they're like, why did you drive 12 hours to come to Dietz? And they're like, I had to see this thing. I keep hearing about it. I had to see it. And I'm like, did it live up to the hype? And it's like, it's amazing. It's like the best atmosphere in American soccer. I'm like, okay. Like, I'm like, I don't believe that, man. Detroit's going to be crazy. I've never been to a Detroit game. Chattanooga, I've been there, and I got goosebumps, right? Mm-hmm. You know, but to have people come and see what we built and to think that is like the most flattering thing that you could ever hear.
I mean, you look across the world, just in clubs in England, here in Germany too, like Sean and I play for clubs here where, you know, this club is their favorite club, and it is not, you know, a Bayern Munich, it's not a Manchester United, but it's where they're from, and it's like, it's passed down. And I feel like Stockade could be that same thing where it's just like, it was my father's club, it's my club, and right. You know, it's just kind of like, it's an essence of it.
That's why I always talk to fans and tell them, like, club's not going anywhere. Like, we're going to work on the club forever, right? It's not, because that's the curse of lower level soccer. Like, oh, a club lasts for 2 years, then it goes away. It's like, no. Like, it's going to last forever.
Yeah, right.
And, you know, and like, I think the thing I was most bummed about this past season is like, I wasn't able to take my two kids to go, because they're finally of the age where they were like,
yeah.
Love Stockade games, right? So I'm really psyched about taking them around, you know. But I grew up in Boston as a Red Sox fan, right? And you know, that's just kind of like instilled in me. It's just kind of born into you. And I remember, you know, like kind of just kind of falling out of love with baseball a couple of years ago, just not caring, and then having Stockade kind of fill that void for me and being like. Yeah. Yeah, of course it makes total sense. Like, you spend all this time building this club, like it's kind of your club, you know, but just being kind of blown away where it's like, this is the thing I care the most about. And it's like, and to have, you know, hundreds of people feel the same way is just like mind blowing.
Yeah, that's amazing. And now, you know, Dylan made a good point, and then Dennis and Danny followed up with it, is that like having Stockade, you guys have now provided a in-person experience for these young kids to strive for, right? This is a viable path that they can one day maybe play for Stockade, right? They can see where they can go. But then, like, let's go one step further, and it's kind of, you know, a dark spot in U.S. soccer is that Stockade at the moment can't move, right? It has to stay in the league that it is. It can't move up leagues.
Yeah.
And it's not like, you know, one day this club, they're going to get all these great players. They're going to get promoted into the next league. And then maybe one day when I grow up, they're going to be in the MLS, you know, and I know you guys have very strong opinions on this. And I think that it is certainly a thing that's holding US soccer back at the moment. So let's talk about this. I mean, you guys have definitely a lot to say about this. You guys have actually filed a lawsuit against US soccer, which I think is incredible. And it's something that really needs to be spoken about in US soccer to bring it forward and to keep players staying in country, because it's kind of almost in a way it's forcing players to leave the country and go elsewhere.
I don't think leaving the country at this moment is a bad thing, you know, like,
right.
Dan and I were talking about this last week. Like, we have this alumni page on a Stockade website, and you know, Dylan, what I think our very first player ever to play abroad, thank you.
So proud.
Bronze statue right now. Everybody, next season.
Okay.
But no, there's like a growing list of like, you know, in the absence of Stockade moving up a level, because that doesn't exist in the US soccer, I don't see a path for it to happen in the near term. In the absence of that, you know, individual players are going on and making careers for themselves abroad. And at some point, you know, do they circle back to the US? At some point, do they not go abroad and they get picked up by MLS, right? So they can be seen domestically. I don't know, right? But it starts with like giving players opportunities to extend their career. And then I think it extends to, or transforms into, you know, how does a team in the Hudson Valley go from being, you know, an amateur team to a professional team to a competitive professional team? And right. What does that journey look like? So, Dan, I'll let you speak.
Yeah. So I think that you know, the word opportunity is really big in the pro rel world, because, like, I mean, you guys playing in Germany, like, you know, bigger clubs are keeping their eye out for you. Are keeping their eye out for lower level clubs, because they know those lower level clubs always have the potential to become a bigger level club. You always have the potential to get to a higher level. You always have the potential to bring your players with you to a higher level. So that network of finding players really exists across across Europe, across you know, South America. That network doesn't exist in the US, where it's like, okay, we have this really great player named Dylan Williams playing for our team. How do we help Dylan Williams get up, you know, to play in USL 2 or USL and help him progress through the US pyramid? Right. There's no network for that. I told Dylan beforehand that Sean, I was going to call you out on a little quote. I wrote it down.
Yes, I love it. Here we go.
Said that you thought of yourself as a business, and that your worth of your business is now more now that you're abroad than if it had been that you stayed and played in the US in the NPSL and USL 2 and so on. And like, to me, that's a problem. Like, that's the essence of the problem in US soccer, that you do not see yourself getting better as a player or getting bigger as a business in playing in US soccer.
Yep.
How do we change that? How do we make it so that players of your guys', you know, resume can improve, can get seen without having, you know, I played at Wake Forest on my resume. I got selected in the bogus MLS super draft. Like, how do we make it so that there's a real pathway for players to be seen? And, you know, you guys took an initiative on yourselves and, you know, worked with Soccer Visa, got yourselves contract. We've had a handful of guys go to Soccer Visa from Stockade. But that's guys taking things into their own hands. It's not just the opportunities being seen by other players. Like, you know, there's no Red Bull scouts coming and watching Stockade games. I mean, shout out to the Red Bulls NYCFC. You guys want to come to Deed Stadium anytime you want. Come check out. Great. But, you know, there's no connection right now between clubs in US soccer, and that hurts players who should be given opportunities. Like, we've had guys, like Dennis said, our alumni, we have a guy playing in you know, for the B team, a La Liga B team right now.
Yeah.
We have guys playing in Division One in Bolivia right now.
Yeah.
You know, we've had guys in Germany, Dylan in Australia, we've had guys in, you know, Scandinavia, all across the world, taking things upon themselves to go find a team to play for because nobody is giving them that chance in US.
And so just to stay with this topic, I mean, just to point out, you know, some of the things that kind of hinder it is that you go abroad and a season is it lasts for the same as a professional season, whether you're playing professional or not. So it can be 8, 9, 10 months. Now an NPSL season, I know there's things that are forming in many of these leagues, but it's one of the things, and especially in college too, is that you're not playing full time. You're not playing, you're not training every single day. So this is just one of the things that I think hinders players. But I mean, how do we form that? How do we become better as a soccer community where these lower tiers, even if it's not a promotion relegation, because like Dennis said, that seems very far away. But, you know, what can we do now?
Well, it's just like there's a huge gap between doing what Stockade is doing, which is playing, you know, 3 or 4 months out of the year, mostly amateur players, a mix of college and like, you know, former college players, you know, and everyone's doing it as like a side hustle, basically. Right. There's a huge difference between that and then, like, you know, going to like a NISA team, right? Which NISA would be, you know, Division III, you know, playing 10 months out of the year, traveling around the country, everyone on salary, right? And so the gap between, and then from NISA, then you go to like USL 2 or something like that, where the budgets get more expensive, and then MLS, which is, you know, top tier in the US. And there's just like there needs to be like stepping stones here. And the NPSL talks about this a lot, right? Okay, well, instead of playing just a 4 month season, you can now play a 6 month season, or you can also play an 8 month season. So you can do, you know, spring and fall, you can do spring and summer, or summer and fall, and you can put it together like Lego blocks, basically. But, you know, depending on your stadium availability, your market size, you know, your own schedule and, you know, budget, you can play however much you want to play, and the NPSL will help you find opponents to play against so you can continue to grow players. And then once you get used to running like an amateur squad for, call it, you know, 6 months or 8 months out of the year, it gets a little bit easier to be like, oh, well, now I'll just do, I'll do 10 months out of the year and I'll do, and I'll migrate over to professional players. But to do both of those jumps at once, amateur to professional and 3 months to 10 months is, and, you know, regional travel, the national travel, it's just three huge roadblocks right. to get over in terms of, you know, the size of your budget increase. And so we don't like that. The US soccer ecosystem doesn't have the right infrastructure to help clubs go from small to big. And it doesn't have the proper financial incentives, right? Just imagine a world in which you could be promoted, right? If you got promoted, you'd go bankrupt because like you just don't have enough money to.
It's completely different. Yeah, the stepping stones.
The financial infrastructure of a lot of the European systems, and you know, there's revenue shares with broadcast revenue if you go up, so you are getting paid, and there's parachute payments if you go down, so there's like a cushion there, and those are long-standing kind of financial mechanisms built to insulate clubs from you know, like the shock of going up or going down, but there's nothing like that here.
And
some, you know, there's going to be a conversation about how does that stuff even happen before you really start to, you know, see some of this.
Anything to add on that, Dan?
Nobody's really on the same page. Like that's one of the biggest things is that U.S. soccer is not on the same page, you know, across the board nationally. Whereas in England and in Germany and in France, like the whole infrastructure, the whole system, the whole pyramid is set up on, you know, the same common ground. It's not like that here. We have like seven different federations, basically. Like the MPSL is so much so separate from USL to, you know, is now its own complete different thing. There's UPSL, there's adult amateur, like there's so many different pathways that it's just everybody is all over the place, scattered, and nobody is together.
It's okay for there to be different leagues, right? Around the country there's different leagues, but the leagues, you know, the leagues just need to accept the fact that they are a container for teams. Teams come in, teams go out. Right? The problem, that's how it exists most everywhere in the world. The problem in the US is that the leagues want to compete with each other. You know, like, well, I don't want to be D3, I want to be D2. Well, I don't want to be D4, D4 and D3. You know, and I always think that the USL is thinking like, someday we're going to be D1. We're going to take over the MLS.
Right.
You've got this really crazy, dysfunctional competitive system where everyone wants to be the top league, as opposed to the USSF just being like, listen, guys, everyone is stuck where they are. Now start working together and move teams up and down the system. Right. And so in the absence of strong leadership from the USSF, you get the league wanting to compete with each other.
Right.
Yeah. And I mean,
a disservice to the teams, to the clubs, and that is a disservice to the players.
We could really have a pyramid that's, you know, 7-8 tiers deep if you start to set. Because I mean, right now USL2, NPSL, and UPSL are all in the same tier. If we were to go, you know, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, tier 5, tier 6, tier 7, it creates more of a pathway for, you know, the potential for Stockade as a tier 4 team to look at UPSL as a tier 5 or a tier 6 teams. Right. You know, those players could come in and they could play for us in tier 4, and then somebody NISA at tier 3 could potentially look at Stockade. It creates more of those connections, more of those opportunities when you have a real laid out layered system.
Right. Yeah. And do it's almost see... like the, ahead, just to continue with that, like when you had the NASL and the USL, who both are, you know, quote unquote second tier, NASL thought they were first tier, but it's what happens is you water down every league. You know, instead of, if you have a pyramid scheme, a lot of pyramid system, like you said, the levels will sort themselves out. No question. The better player, the best players will be in the MLS, the better, then you have the USL and then go on and so forth. That will sort itself out in a season or two. No problem, because the higher the league, the more incentive the players will have to play there. Right. You don't have to worry about, but now you have all these leagues competing for the best players. So you have a handful of good players in this league, a handful in this league, and then everyone has very mediocre players. And it, like you said, it's just, you have eight different leagues competing for the same spot. It's totally backwards against the rest of the world in the game.
One of the things, one of the only way that I think that, like, you know, the paradigm gets broken is if there's a non-MLS team that becomes really dominant in the US Open Cup. And this was my hope for the Cosmos for a while. The Cosmos is one of the, you know, an owner with really, really deep pockets. They were operating in NISA. I know they're taking like a year off now, but went from NASL down to NISA. And of course their B squad played in the NPSL. Mm-hmm. I was always hoping that they would make a huge, like, put together this killer roster of players, you know, just assemble them from players around the world and make a really deep run in the US Open Cup. And I always thought, like, if you got to the point where a non-MLS team won the US Open Cup for like 2 out of 3 years or something,
right.
You really get people paying attention, like, whoa, this fantasy about like MLS being top flight, that's not true, that there's other teams that can compete. Right. And then, you know, instead of just playing once a year in the Open Cup, you're starting to see that type of interplay. And then you've got people being like, why isn't this team in MLS,
right? Yeah, right.
Like, you know, you talk about, like, what is the one thing that makes the infrastructure crumble? I always thought it's like a non-MLS team being dominant in the Open Cup is one of the things that has to happen before the system really starts to change, or people really start to understand, oh, the system could be different.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, 100%.
And that almost happened. I think it was 2015. I was at the game. The Cosmos beat NYCFC in the cup.
I was in that game too. Yeah, and to advance, not to win, but to advance.
Yes, yes.
You were at that game out in Long Island.
Yeah, at Hofstra. Yeah.
That was the game where I was like, we have to put Stockade together.
Oh, right? My God.
Wow.
I was in the stands.
You were probably sitting next to each other.
Where my Cosmos t-shirt being like, because you know what happened is, you know, Cosmos powerhouse team in the 70s, you know, kind of fell aside. A private equity group, like investors, came together and said, we're going to buy the brand. We're going to resurrect it. And we're going to make this team come back. And I remember being in the stadium being like, oh, so this team was dead for like 12 years. Someone just brought it back to life. And there's 10,000 people here as they beat NYCFC.
And,
like,
and you have Raul playing for you.
Yeah. Like, and I was there with my buddies and I was like,
crazy.
This is what we're doing. How do we do this? It was not to go back to the original story, but it was like, we were at that bar in Brooklyn, Angry Wades, you know, after our own pickup game, having the conversation about the US Open Cup. We went to this game like 3 weeks later. And then, you know, 3 weeks after that, I had stumbled into Deet Stadium being like, holy cow, this is it. This is the place, you know? And it was those three things, like week after week after week,
right.
Just kind of came together.
We didn't know it, but somehow Sean was involved.
Yes.
You're welcome.
What a crazy game.
What a crazy game, though. I think the Cosmos scored at like the 89th minute.
Yeah.
To tie it, to send it into overtime.
The end. We were sitting at the far end.
That was crazy. I was sitting like right next to the drumming section behind the goal.
That's cool. Good story. All right.
Crazy though. But yeah. that was, for example, though, that they were a better team. Like, they were the better team on the day for sure.
Yeah.
But it did go to penalties, but like they were just better. They had better players. I know Leo Fernandez was there at the time. He was a Long Island native. They had Raul, obviously, incredible player. But NYCFC, I believe, had Davavia at the time. So it's like they had big players too, but the Cosmos had a very good roster. They had a lot of good players.
But that was an incredible environment that the Cosmos supporters put on. That's going to be a tough environment to come and play in. And you know, you guys know this, and Dylan from being at Stockade, like there are teams that maybe should have beaten us at Deets that did not beat us because the energy was just on our side. And it sounds corny to say, but when you're there, you feel it. And I can only imagine what to be on the field. Feeling the energy from the fans, and you know, and only imagine what it's like 10x that, literally 10x. You're talking about 10,000 fans at the Cosmos Stadium.
Yeah,
the NYCFC went on to play the Red Bulls like a week after that, I'll see you in a little bit. And they lost. That's how they got knocked out of the Open Cup. But like, you know, it's funny, Sean, you and I both remember it as like, they won the whole thing, right? Yeah. That game was so, it was so emotional.
Yeah.
Just to bring it to a personal level with Stockade, I mean, this was 2020 was my, no, 2019 was my last spell, right? So it was a game against the Italians, correct me if I'm wrong, Dan, where we go two men down, right, in the second half.
I already had chills.
Oh, yeah, it was incredible experience.
I did the same thing. I'm
already.
Wow. But this was, this is just.
Story? I'm missing out.
Have you ever heard this? Go, Dan, take it away from here.
All right, so there was a little scrum on the field.
Set the stage. It's the last game of the season.
So it's the last home game. It's the last home game of the year. We are on this crazy, like, 10-match unbeaten streak in 2019. You know, we're, like, third place in the table, but we have the Cosmos and the Brooklyn Italians right ahead of us, these two prestigious clubs, you know, in and around the city. And – you know, we have never picked up a point before 2019 against the Cosmos or Brooklyn. Now, we had already drew Brooklyn at Aviator earlier in this year, which actually, I believe, started the big long run with a late goal. We scored like an 88th minute header to equalize at Aviator. But so now we're back at Dietz. There's like 1,400 people at Dietz. I believe there was a rain delay.
That was the same game. Oh yeah, there was a big rain delay.
It was like a 40-minute rain delay, lightning delay. Yeah. People got sent back to their cars, and 1,400, 1,200 people still came back to the stadium 40 minutes later for the game. Crazy. So, you know, we're down 1-0 early, and a couple of our guys, I believe we leveled. Yes, we leveled. I believe Zobri scored. We went level 1-1.
Scotty.
There was a little scrum. One of our players, you know, elbowed a guy in a little bit of a scrum, got a red card. Another one of our players was addressing it with the referee. The referee stepped off the field, which apparently is a referee tactic, be away from players. I've never seen it before. But and he stepped off the field after the referee gave him a second yellow. So we went down two men, like, within a flash.
No.
So we go down. We go down 2-1. We're fighting and crawling. It's like the 92nd minute at this point. One of our center backs gets forward, blocks a clearance. The ball bounces around. This 18-year-old kid, Brady Van Epps, bangs it into the back of the net.
18 years old, yeah.
In the 94th minute, he's at Brown now. Before that, he was a senior in high school. Equalizer, 1,400 people at Dietz Stadium going absolutely mad. Our guys on the bench are running onto the field. It looked like we just won the World Cup on a last second goal. Literally, wow. Afonso Pinheiro, shout out to Fonzi, ex-DC United super draft pick, was literally out in the middle of the field off the bench celebrating. It was absolutely madness. I'm going to have to send you the clip later.
Yeah, please do.
And it was a draw just to keep us in it.
Yeah.
Right.
And that was, we needed at least a point so that when we had two more games against Boston and the Cosmos later on in the year, that if we had, you know, gotten points from both of those games, we could have snuck into that two spot for playoffs. So we
that was unbelievable.
I'm getting chills. Yeah. I remember like seeing that second red, and I just remember running over to Jamal and being like, all right, Jamal, what's the plan? Like, where are we going? We have nine guys. So like, let's think about this. We're going to want to stack, and we want to, like, you know, hit them on the counter for one opportunity, but we got to keep this a one goal game. And like, we did. Shout out to, 18 years old, and you can come in and score against, you know, 1,400 fans. That's just another reason about Stockade and how it's like connecting that way.
Yeah, I mean,
what you're good for.
On the field.
There he is.
That's the pitch I was
looking for. Everybody on the field, like, I mean, you guys know, like, going down a man, hard enough to be going down two men. You know, we had guys playing in the middle of the field. Dylan, you know, Paul Bakaj was on the field, plays at Fordham. Frankie Lucevic, who plays at Gonzaga, was on the
players.
Field.
Good guys.
We had kids on the field, like young freshmen, sophomores, high school kids on the field going, and like making a name for themselves in that moment. It was wild. And we have,
I mean,
one of the coolest things, you know, I think that Kale is like, there's
wow, look at that crowd.
That is amazing.
One of the things that Dennis talked about Kale before, one of the biggest things that Kale's responsible, in my opinion, for is our stream. Our stream is like high quality.
Oh,
now.
It's crisp.
It was me with an iPad in 2016, and now it's like high res cameras in 2019 season.
Flying around.
It's it's amazing.
We have an English stream and a Spanish stream at home games. And the Spanish telecast of this goal is something that every
single I don't think I've ever seen this. This is going to be a great little surprise on this episode.
Yeah. Oh, it's
slides it right into this. Yeah,
we might have to put it in this. This might have to be in here.
Put it in. Yeah, you're gonna have to get some editing skills on
here. I'll send you guys the links to some of the photos, and you gotta like.
Please do. Oh, for sure.
It's absolutely insane.
Would this be on YouTube, the Spanish version?
It's on Instagram. I'll send it to you. I can clip it and put it on. I can send you the clip, whatever.
If you can just send it to me on Messenger right now, I can get it up for us on a nice little screen share.
Dan, okay. It's crazy that the moment you started telling that, I literally just got the.
I did too. Yeah.
It's just
the odd one out here.
I mean, that's crazy. Sean. Hey, that's, Sean. I always told Dan, I'll be back.
We will be back one day. Sure.
So we'll bring Sean.
We'll be back.
You know, I know we're going to talk about recruiting and scouting a little bit more. Dill, it should be on your phone now. The scouting and recruiting world, we'll talk about a little bit more, but I actually had to go back and do some digging to see if you were on our original 2016 recruiting list. I think you slipped through the cracks a little bit. I'm going to have to talk to the scouting staff.
Wow. About
this. I think maybe the Long Island roots I was too busy, probably turned you off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The far East New Yorker.
Pretty far away.
Dan, I'm not getting it. Unfortunately, I haven't received a text.
I sent it to you on Instagram.
Oh, on Instagram. Okay. My apologies. People are going to have to bear
Dennis,
with us.
Do you have to go, Dennis? I know it's
yeah,
it's
I'll bounce in a minute. Anything you guys wanted, I sent you the link I had for that from that game. And so share that with these guys too. So they have it.
I'm on it.
If you do have just 1 second, Dennis, I wanted to ask you just about one, you know, bigger topic we wanted to get into was this pay to play. So for both of you guys, I know there's a great project with the Stockade Youth Project and things that you guys are trying to do to bridge that gap between, you know, the youth and just giving them the opportunity to, play soccer at a young age and choose soccer maybe over a different sport. So, you know, what are your thoughts on pay to play and how do you feel like we can evolve the system from where it is now?
This is Dan. This is for you, buddy.
Oh, Dan, get it.
Yeah, this is kind of my pay per play system is kind of my baby. It's a really complex conversation, and I know you guys have had conversations in the past. Like I was texting you after your Joe Funicello podcast, and like he talked about the best players play for free, and like I just want to like say right from the get go here that that's true. He's right. But like, how do you become the best player at a club?
I was just talking about this with Dylan.
You have to get involved in that club at 6, 7, 8 years old to become the best player at that club. And that costs money. It puts financial burdens on families that, you know, they ultimately end up looking for sports that are cheaper. Is basketball cheaper? Like, you know, I don't know that it's necessarily every situation, but, you know, how many professional basketball players could have been like superstar soccer players. You know what I mean?
Just think of LeBron James as the goal.
Or American football players. Like, look at all those athletes. Imagine.
For sure. You know, there's this age old conversation about how like Odell Beckham Jr. was in the US Soccer Development Academy for a while. And like, if he had committed to US soccer and wasn't playing football, like OBJ is probably like starting alongside Pulisic on a wing, like scoring goals.
Definitely a winger. Yeah, 100%.
Definitely a winger.
You know, it's just this.
Guys, I'm.
Pay-per-play is a broken mechanism. And it's basically a concept that makes money for clubs. Like, so I wrote down the definition. I got a little post-it note here. It says pay-for-play is a phrase used for in a variety of situations in which money is exchanged for services or the privilege to engage in certain activities. Like, right. That word privilege stands out really, really explicitly to me. Mm-hmm. Like, it's a privilege. And, you know, Joe's right when he says that the best players play for free, ultimately. But we have to get to that point. And it's not cheap, even at a very young age, when other sports can be a lot more inexpensive. And yeah. The whole pay-for-play system is a game. It really is, because families get in the mindset that, oh, I'm playing for my local club. I'm playing for, you know, Poughkeepsie Town Soccer. I'm playing for Kingston KASL. And if I want my kid to get to the point where they can play college soccer or they can, you know, play to the highest level, I have to bring them to play at, you know, Quick Strike or, you know, any of these big pay-for-play clubs around the area that charge, what, $2,500, $3,000
to start, yeah, until right. They know if you're good or not, really, in a way.
So the ultimate question becomes, like, how do we reduce the cost? And that's you know, one of the biggest pieces of, you know, the Stockade Youth Program. It's like, how do we reduce that cost? But the question that I always want to ask is, like, $3,000 per kid, do you really think that's how much it costs to run one soccer team, $3,000 per kid per year? Like, at 18 kids, that's $54,000 a year.
Yeah.
Right. It's crazy. Like, I mean, I read your article, so it's a little bit cheating, but yeah. We'll share the link to that article because it's very good. It's very well written, and it exactly. Is that how much it really costs for, you know, a 12-year-old to play soccer?
Yeah. So in that article, I try to break down a little bit more about what, like, the real costs are. We talk about league fees and ref fees and field space, uniform costs, training costs, you know, like coaching stipend, things like that. It does add up, but, you know, $54,000 per year, you could run an MPSL club.
Yeah.
Right.
Not a U8.
Yeah.
Now let's come back to this, Dan, because I do want to talk more on it. But I know Dennis, his time is valuable, and we have to play this before he goes. So you guys seeing the screen share right here?
Yeah, yeah. Let's
try and blow this up as much as we can. Oh, man.
That's what you live for.
Absolutely. Unreal.
Beautiful game.
Yeah. I mean, that's probably, like, one of the, you know, top three highlights we have as a club. But, you know, realistically, you get something like that every year that just, like, it allows you to feel it running through your blood, like, 2 years later.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I meet so many people in tech and they're like, why are you working on this, like, small soccer thing? And I'm like, because it makes you feel good. It's just like
the most rewarding
thing you can spend your time on, you know? And it's, I mean, just seeing these clips and having this conversation just makes me want to get back on the field this year.
I can't wait till you guys get back on the field, man. Can't wait.
One day, Stockade, MLS. One day in the future. Far in the future. But
MLS, it'll be something else.
So just to quote Dennis, what Dennis always says when I have those big dreams, like Sean just said, he just always says, sounds expensive.
At
that point, Footwork will be a big sponsor of the club.
Yeah, don't worry. Just we're going to be a patch on the jersey at that point.
Oh, yeah.
Across the chest.
Right across the chest.
Once we start getting paid for all these amazing Stockade players playing, you know, transferring around the world.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, there's a big cost involved with that, too.
Bronze statue of Dylan.
Yeah.
I thought that was already in process.
I thought you were using aluminum foil.
It's in the blueprint for the Dietz revitalization there, right?
If it's made out of one of the local IPAs, then I'm signing off on it, definitely.
Nice little Keegan beer right there.
Oh, yeah. We need Keegan beer as a sponsor of Footwork, too. Amazing stuff.
Let's get a, let's get him on the on Stockade first, and then we'll send the extra.
Fair enough.
Well, Dennis, I mean, if you, we're so thankful that you gave us the time to speak to us. It was amazing.
Yeah, super fun. I mean, I'll tell everyone, you know, like, hey, if you're interested in the club, we're at Stockade FC on Instagram, on Twitter, stockadefc.com if you want to follow the story on the website. And then I'm always pretty easy to get in touch with online. I'm just at Dens, D-E-N-S, on all these different platforms. And always happy to answer questions for anyone about any of this stuff. So just come and find me. And then I'm going to sneak out and go take the kids to the playground. And Dan, I think you guys are going to stay on it and talk some more pay-for-play stuff. But
yes, sir.
It's been awesome. Thanks so much for having me on. It's
great. Thank you, Dennis.
Thank you. It was our pleasure.
He's a busy man. He's got a lot of big responsibilities.
That's got to feel good though, from your standpoint, Dan, is that he slid in your DMs. You know, that's got to be like good for the.
Yeah, I mean,
he came searching for you.
I'd be walking around like
the love to the, you know, to AO Hudson Valley. It wasn't specifically me, but
you're a co-founder of the Hudson Valley Outlaws branch. Yeah.
Yeah.
You must have been running around that summer school classroom that day.
Like,
all right, kids,
we're
going to learn today.
A little extra recess on this day while I do some research. No,
we're going to do some math on how we start a club.
Yeah, so I kind of had to, like, because I was at school, I had to throw a little bit more reliance on my buddy Corey and Jeff Payne, our other co-founder. To do a little bit more work. I messaged him back immediately when I woke up that morning, like, yeah, because his question was, would a soccer club work in the Hudson Valley, specifically in Kingston? And I was like, yeah.
Soccer club? Like, he didn't specify it would be like, you know, level or anything?
Not specifically from the start. I think he was trying to gauge us out, but, you know, we had conversation after conversation, and then ultimately I became one of, like, the first board of advisory board people with Mike Milberger, who was working at MLS at the time, who's still working with us, and Greg Lawless, who's Alexi Lawless's brother, who that's probably not the most flattering thing for Greg. I'm sorry, Greg. Greg
Lawless, depends on who you ask, I guess.
Yeah, Greg Lawless, who's an amazing MLS executive who just happens to be related to Alexi.
Better put.
And then myself, Dennis, and then Randy Kim, who was our original GM, who, you know, works for Dazen and in the sports world.
Yeah.
So we have a lot of big people, you know, real soccer mindsets, sports mindsets, business mindsets. And then I think that I was Valley tie.
Dan, I wanted to ask you about this because, I mean, after our Joe episode, we talked about obviously the promotion relegation, and we had some responses on some of the social medias that just saying this promotion relegation only hurts the lower clubs in terms where there's only a few clubs that can win the league. As I mean, if you look in like an EPL, there's really 6-7 clubs. I mean, Leicester. And it is changing a little bit here and there, but there are this group of clubs that can win and then the rest don't. So a lot of people point to this as why the MLS is more quote unquote competitive, especially if you ask Alexi Lawless. And I asked Joe about this as well. And I wanted to get your take on like what competitive means to you in comparison of these two different types of leagues.
So I think what you're talking specifically about is competitive on the field. And, you know, I think of the clubs also like a business too. And, you know, when you're talking about Manchester United versus, you know, who, Aston Villa, somebody like that, some of the smaller teams, Brighton, you know, you're talking about the revenue share is pretty equal in the EPL. So these clubs are making similar amounts of money. Now, have additional investors like the Glazer family, Manchester United, you know, spends tons and tons of money to bring in guys like Bruno, whereas smaller clubs don't take those risks. They, you know, try to keep their club financially stable because they don't have these billionaire competitors. So when I think of competitive, I'm thinking in terms of finances. You know, they're making choices on where to spend their money. So
yeah,
that's my take on it. Like MLS is, it's like one big bank account. MLS, they put all their money in a pot. MLS helps bring in the Joseph Martinez's and mm-hmm. the David Beckham's and things like that, and helps finance. But like every player in MLS doesn't sign a, you know, New York Red Bulls contract or a Houston Dynamo contract. They signed an MLS contract specifically with those teams. So they belong to MLS, not specifically to the team. So MLS is a corporation. Manchester United is a corporation. Aston Villa is a corporation. And then, you know, Sunderland is a corporation down into the championship. So they're all individual entities. So it changes things really. I think that MLS would have to change that model in order to go promotion relegation. And like Dennis was saying before, the leagues are in competition. The league is looking to make money, not necessarily right. the team, whereas the leagues in England are that container, like he said.
Yeah, right.
We don't have that structure here to even enable it, because the leagues are they're a corporation. MLS right. is a corporation. The Premier League is a container. It holds corporations.
Right. Wow, I did not know that. Now that makes total sense why promotion relegation is not even on the table, because that would mean every year they're going to lose a piece of their business. They're losing a team or two.
If NYCFC got relegated to the USL, like would all the players that are on NYCFC have to stay in MLS on whatever team got promoted? Like, I don't even know how that would work with the current model of MLS, just the way the contracts are set up. Like, that's the point of the designated player model. In MLS, you get the three bigger contracts outside of your salary cap because the MLS owns them. MLS pays those contracts. They pay it with their, like, $5 million annual buy-in per team. So it's a very different model than anywhere else in the world, and it creates a lot of difficulties when you start talking about promotion relegation. Honestly, believe that the biggest piece to get promotion relegation in the U.S. would be to do it in the lower tiers.
I was just going to ask, is that something you see more possible as a 2-7?
I think that's – yeah, so, you know, USL and MLS are very connected. There's a lot of – MLS 2 teams in USL, and then obviously the PDL USL 2, they could create their own little pyramid. And then if we had a separate pyramid where it was NISA, NPSL, UPSL, and then, you know, some amateur leagues and things like that, we would be able to create a structure of promotion relegation with just those tiers. So like I said before, if we went 7-8 tiers deep rather than having 9 leagues in tier 4, we could create something like that would help to, but there'd have to be some sort of revenue. And, you know, Dennis can talk to you all day about the revenue share on leagues and stuff like that, but you'd have to have some sort of, you know, the NPSL is using MyKuju to stream games, but is there a revenue piece for that?
Right.
No, it's just a way for us to be more accessible.
Yeah.
If we were to, you know, say NISA had a Nike sponsorship and NPSL didn't have that. When you got promoted to NISA, you would get that Nike sponsorship. You know, there has to be some sort of financial backing to get into the league. What's the goal? Is it just to be in a higher league, or is there some sort of financial piece to help you?
So you're Germany, for example, you have, you know, from the first league to there's nine tiers, but in the lower tiers there's multiple leagues in like a specific region. But the thing is, like, just say the Hamburg Oberliga, the fifth tier, you have 20 teams in that league, but they're all in the city. Like, for example, Stockade, if you're gonna play, go up a level, now the travel cost is astronomically higher than it was in this current league that you're in. So I don't even know if that is viable, because there's not enough teams in the local area where your travel cost is going to bring your revenue.
It would have to be regioned off.
It'd have to be region.
Yeah, it would have to be region off.
That You'd have to increase the, I mean, NISA right now is like, I think it's like 8 to 10 teams. So if NPSL yeah. was to merge with NISA, like there's like 100 teams in NPSL. So we could potentially have an NPSL 1 and NPSL 2. But
okay.
we'd have to get a few teams to move into NISA to start with to help regionalize it. Because
right.
you know, the closest team to us currently, if you take the Cosmos out, is this new Amsterdam FC team, which mm-hmm. is in the city. And then I think from there, you know, we're headed to Detroit. So
yeah.
there has to be revenue share to make that feasible for teams. How do we get them a little bit? Because you're talking about an operating budget in the NPSL that includes travel for us to go to Boston and Hartford and Rhode Island
yeah.
on a bus.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden we have to take either like, what is it? Like 12-hour ride to Detroit, or we're going to take a flight out of Detroit. There's got to be some sort of revenue share in order to
pay for those costs. Yeah. Not, like,
go bankrupt when they,
yeah.
right.
when they increase leagues, there's gotta be a prize to move forward. Not just being, oh, I'm in a higher league, like hold your shoulders higher.
Right.
It's a great point. Dana, just to switch gears here, that you said that you had a funny story about me being recruited onto Stockade. And I was just wondering, I'm not sure it'll paint me in the best light, but maybe you could share for everyone out there.
Well, we have a very, very extensive recruiting and scouting process. My brother, Nick Hoffay, is like this. I mean, he's a crazy recruiter. He watches hours and hours and hours.
I didn't know that, actually. Wow, okay.
Like, he sits here. Like, last night, he watched, like, 7 hours of games. Just last night. We watched the UAlbany game yesterday. He watched the Stony Brook game. And, like, I pop on, I take little pictures, and I say that I watched them. I post them on Twitter.
I saw that. I didn't see that you posted on Twitter.
Yeah, he's got – it's all, like – I'm like the front man to him doing right. all this back work. So in 2016, like, he spent months compiling, like, this big, long Google sheet of – it was, like, somewhere in the 200 range of players from our area that were playing college soccer, specifically wow. college soccer, or guys that were just out of college soccer. And Dylan was one of those players. And that's why I was talking about Sean before, that when I said I had to go back and do some digging to see if you were on that list.
He missed the Far East, New York.
Long Island piece. But so, you know, we had conversations with people about different players and coaches. And, you know, I talked to Byrne, and I talked to a whole bunch of coaches from different areas talking about players. And Dylan's name came up a lot. You know, through research, through talking to people, but then more specifically through Jamal, who I know you guys had on, who
yeah.
you guys determined coached against you while you were at school. So Jamal was like, oh, there's this crafty little midfielder that plays for Oneonta. And we were like, that's Dylan Williams. So we were like, we got to get in contact with this kid. So I had asked Byrne for your email. I believe I had sent you an email sometime in December. Byrne gave me your email. Dylan didn't respond. So a couple of weeks later, we had been in contact with another Oneonta player, Darren Gomez,
yep.
who played for us in 2016. And I went back in my emails and was looking to see how all this happened. And I had said to Darren, like, can you give me Dylan's email? And Darren gave me Dylan's, like, personal email, not his Oneonta email. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to try again. And I was like, Darren, let Dylan know that really we want him to play. So it kind of became like this obsession, and we were worried that, like, Dylan was going to show up and he was going to suck, and we were going to be like, we spent a lot of time on this. So there was a lot of expectation to live up to. But you ever heard the term white whale? White whale is like something that you like obsess over. Like right. Dylan was Nick's white whale. This was like the player that he needed to get.
How are we going to get him?
Guy.
So I had been worried, and he was on me about it constantly. Have you heard from Dylan? Have you heard from Dylan? Like, constantly. We need to get this kid. He needs to anchor the midfield. So we have our first ever tryout on a Saturday. I don't know what the exact date was, but it was sometime in March 2016.
Yeah.
Dylan, no show. We plan things out. We're getting things ready. So George Visvari was our first ever Stockade coach. Local legend. You know, played professionally, Hungarian, old school, tells you how he sees it, never lies to you kind of guy. To the point where he actually, I asked Nick if I could tell this story too, but he actually in the first tryout cut a kid right in front of his brother to the coaches. He was like, the brother was standing on the sideline. The kid he wanted to cut was on the field, and he would turn to the coaches and he was like, him out, like right next. The brother was standing right next to him. So he never, he just does, he just, he never cared. It was just like, I'm going to do this how I want to do it. And it's, you know, how I feel, old school, no BS, all honest all the time. So Thursday night before our first tryout, Dylan emails me back. I have it written right here. I'm sorry for the delay. I needed to work out a couple of things so that I could attend this Saturday. I hope the invite is still in place as I would very much like to attend. Thank you for your time and reaching out. Very professional, very nice.
Very proper.
I either text or George, and I'm like, Dylan's coming. He's like, no, he's not. He's too late. I have tryouts set up. He's like, this kid's not coming. So I was like, he was like, tell him he can't come. And I was like, okay, I'm not going to argue with George, but I didn't tell him Dylan couldn't come. Dylan showed up anyway. I told Dylan to come. So we knew we had to get him on. So good thing happens. Some kid didn't show up. No idea who he is, but he didn't show up.
Shout out to that tryout. Guy.
So there was one spot.
Shout out to that There's guy. One spot right.
Open on a team. So I was like, listen, George, Dylan's coming. And a spot opened on this team. So we're going to put him on this team. He goes, fine, he plays left back. So Dylan hops onto the field playing left back. Like within 3 minutes of him playing, George looks over at us and he's like, he's on the team. Like it took 3 minutes from Thursday night, him not wanting anything to do with this kid, to 3 minutes on the field. He's like, he's on the team. And now Dylan's jersey is right there. That white Trailways jersey up on the top is actually Dylan's jersey. It's really in there because one day it's going to be in the Stockade offices once we have, you know, legit offices.
That's sick.
Jersey. And he's got a freaking Bayern Leverkusen jersey hanging behind him. Like, you know, things.
We're going to have, I'm going to have to get you guys just one from Notre State for you guys to have too. Depending on how large this is. That definitely. Gift from me for being an asshole and you know and
it's your damn email,
you're
kid.
An asshole. Listen, you know one of the biggest things with recruiting that we always talk about is communicating with these kids. Like we're talking about college players, so the Stockade equipment is over to my right now, and I don't know if you can hear this, but a random stopwatch is going off. I've never heard that before in this room. so it threw me off
barely though. There.
But one of the biggest things is communication. Like it's difficult to get an 18, 19 year old kid to commit. So when you start talking to kids about, you know, getting them in for a trial, following NCAA guidelines, we're talking to them in December or January. Kids are like, I don't know what I'm going to do this summer. Like it's very difficult. So, I mean, the easy part, identifying kids, you know, seeing stats, talking to coaches, you know, we've developed a really, really good relationship with a lot of area coaches like Trevor Gorman at University of Albany, Matt Vigiano at Marist. We have good relationships with Siena, Iona, Binghamton, Stony Brook. Like we have really good relationships with a lot of schools. So identifying kids is the easy part. The difficult part is communicating with them. Just like that situation with Dylan, like these kids don't know where they're going to be tomorrow, let alone in May to be playing for our program.
That's a great point. I mean, I was probably thinking about, you know, where I was going that weekend, but exactly. I don't think that I had made my decision on if I was going to like pursue JP Morgan and be an investment guy and I would be in the city. So I think there was a lot weighing on my mind not to, but I still think how do I feel about it?
How do you feel about that decision? You happy you didn't go work at JP Morgan in the city?
I don't regret it in the slightest. I'm very happy with how things have turned out and continue to turn out.
You should be.
But yeah, kids, I'll just say, kids, answer your email. Even if you just say, you know, I'm not sure yet. Just get back to people.
Yeah. Communicate, be honest. Like, that's one of the biggest things, you know, be honest, tell us, you know, I'm not sure what I'm doing yet. Can I check back with you in a month?
Yeah. Yeah. That transparency, like you've mentioned very early in this episode, it goes a very long way, and people can, they'll give you the benefit of the doubt when you are transparent. It's like, okay, well, no, George may have put me at left back, but you know, Sean's seen me play right wing back in the Cosmos game, and
did well. Future position.
I don't know. I think you could play it. I don't know if it's exactly your idea.
And another,
you can do a job.
In another lifetime, I was at JP Morgan and I was playing right back in a city league. It's in a different life.
For the Greeks.
So I, when you guys talked about, when you reached out to me, Dylan, about the, you know, the CV, we had talked about your CV and, you know, pinpointing those exact skills that you have and saying that you can turn on a dime and, you know, you're shifty in small spaces. I don't think that would exactly work out so well at left back.
It's a good point.
That is a good point.
You know, I think that's one of your biggest attributes. And, you know, it's, you're not going to get into those open spaces to be turning on guys in your own 18.
You never know. Yeah. Depends on who I'm playing for, I guess.
And I think I can recall, Dan, your advice was for players making highlight videos that you really love it when they put the highlight video to Who Let the Dogs Out, right?
So, and it's 10 minutes.
I believe that was one of my best quotes ever. And I was very proud of myself after that quote. I've had some bad ones, Sean. We've gotten some, like, you know, it's one thing to, you know, I think that guys try to put bad music in sometimes to stand out.
Baby,
yeah, exactly. putting your games to the Titanic soundtrack does not make me want to watch more.
No. Yeah. I mean, luckily sending it to you, you're a young guy, but you got to think, like, you send it to these college coaches. Imagine Visvari is listening to, like, you know, a deep house techno song with a ton of bass. Like, he's not going to want to look. Like, it's got to be like instrumental, yeah, like not too much.
You want the content to speak for itself.
Right,
And not have the music destroy it
or distract you from the actual content. Exactly.
Completely.
Unless you're not a great player and this is your way.
This is your way. Yeah. Hey, edit the hell out of it, you know? Yeah. Transitions, go CGI, on. Green screens, do what you gotta do, I guess.
Yeah. Put video of Ronaldo up. Yeah.
Yeah. Just your head on it. Yeah,
your head on it.
Anything.
Yeah. Playing at zero.
Oh man, Dan, when we were making these notes, I was trying to think of a good wrap up question, and I knew we would be all over the place today. So what I came up with is, if you can, in a few sentences, you know, rather short, can you explain for us what your U.S. soccer utopia looks like?
I guess the biggest thing would be that it would be accessible to everybody. You know, it would be small community soccer building to bigger clubs like Stockade, building to even bigger clubs like the Red Bulls in New York City, where the game is accessible to every single kid across the United States. You know, like, I don't think as much about the bigger picture, like the bigger clubs, the leagues and things like that. I think more about the kids and, you know,
the grassroots.
That's my background. I'm an teacher. That's me. But, like, you know, Dennis and I talk about this thing about all the time where it's like, how do we help the U.S. national team get better? How does Stockade help the U.S. national team get better? And really, it's about helping more kids find their greatest potentials in the game. It's about giving them the opportunity where it's not becoming a question of, can we pay for it? It's a question of, okay, you want to play soccer? Let's go. Let's give it a shot. See if you enjoy it. See if you have fun. And then you get high level training to be the best player that you can. Like, I mean, that's really the Stockade Youth Program's mission, is just to create inclusive soccer opportunities for all kids in the Hudson Valley, regardless of their social or economic status in the world. Like, that shouldn't matter. That's my utopian, is this like this
accessibility.
Yeah, soccer is just available to everybody.
I love that. I really love that. Now, Dan, I mean, Dennis shouted out the Stockade roots and where to find everyone on Instagram and stuff. Is there anything else that people can look, you know, to maybe donate a few dollars to the youth program to help support in any way?
Yeah. So two of the biggest things that we do for the youth program is we have, like a ticket purchase. You can obviously we're not 100% ready for a 2021 season yet. You know, we're working towards it. I want to be completely honest with people. There's some obstacles in our way, but we're working through them and we're hopeful. But, you know, once we have season ticket things, we do put a feature in where you can, somebody from Utah that wants to get involved in Stockade and buy a season ticket, you can buy that season ticket and it gets donated to one of like the local boys and girls clubs, youth program, things like that across the area. So we have that piece of it. And then also we do an international tee every year. So we have our main Stockade t-shirt, but then we do it in different international logos. Like we have a Japanese one, we have one
in Hebrew.
So whenever we do a variation of that, a percentage of that goes towards our youth program. So check out,
is there any new ones out?
We're creating a new one. There, we had one last year that we put out that said stay home, save lives instead of the Stockade logo. We have one that says support local soccer, and then we have the foreign ones. We're still working on what this year's will be, but when any of those shirts, the large portion of the profits goes towards the youth program. So stockadefc.com/store.
yeah, awesome. Look out for that, and when it comes we'll be sure to post that too, because I want one. I missed out on the Japanese and the there was another one that I wanted too. I think my mom got it though, so I think there's one available in my house back in New York. So,
all right,
we got
to
look out for it.
I'll have to see if I can. I'll just scrounge a couple up and send them out to you guys. The one thing, Sean, if you've never had a Stockade t-shirt, Stockade t-shirts are the softest cotton material. It's like wearing a pillow on your body.
They
make you
look amazing.
They make you look ripped.
They make you look ripped, and it's so comfortable.
Your bicep.
I need one of these.
They're nice. We're gonna have to send.
And while we're on this topic, can you buy one? Could I go on the store and buy one of these t-shirts?
Yep. Yeah. So if you went on the store, we have anything from masks are up there to jerseys, and we don't, we're a small entity. So when you talk about us getting jerseys, we buy like 30 of them until they're sold out, and then we go and we refill get more and refill the store, because it doesn't financially make any sense for us to buy 500 jerseys and just have them sitting there. So there tends to be a lot of things that get sold out, but as soon as they get sold out, we start the process of replenishing. I think our masks are sold out right now, but scarves, masks, any one of our, I think we have 5 jerseys up for sale, from our original ones, like the white one that Dylan's wearing, to our current, the black ones with the topo lines of the Hudson Valley on them. This Foursquare one over here to my side is a collector's item. I think
Dylan's I have that hanging up in my basement. That was our
like training top for the first year. It was like we had two white Trailways, and then we had a black Trailways one, and then we had the gray Foursquare was like our training top. So that's a collector's item. But yeah, there's tons of stuff on the store to go and purchase to support the club and rep some really, really high quality gear.
Yeah, cool. High quality.
Awesome.
Amazing. Now, Dan, are you familiar with our outro at all? Some people don't make it that far, so we have to ask.
All right. So, yes, to a degree. I don't know
You just have to say the very last part.
The plug, pass line.
The most important line.
Plug, and pass.
Plug, and pass.
I told you. I've been listening. I've been listening for a while now, since I don't remember what was the first episode I listened to, but I've gone back and I've listened to some parts of some episodes. Like I listened to part of your episode with Jamal, our head coach. I've listened to your Burn episode, but I love you both, but Wags is my favorite.
He's a fan favorite, and he's gonna be.
We get this a lot
to hear this.
We get this a lot, and we're not gonna tell him. So we got to make sure that he makes it this far.
We'll make sure that we edit this part out.
Yeah.
I mean, this is why we keep doing these Premier League, all these types of episodes.
This is why we keep him around.
I know.
Wags is a man of the people.
Yes, I agree. He's hilarious.
I love it. And if you're into sports betting, he's a decent guy to know.
Yeah.
I was a little upset listening to the Prem one that nobody picked my United to win the title this year, but that's all right. Did you?
I mean, I'm a United fan, just like you, but.
No, I would have picked us probably in fourth.
Okay. I put second, so you can't get mad.
I probably would have went fourth. I probably would have went City, Liverpool, Spurs, United.
Arsenal, did we put Liverpool? I did put Liverpool second. I wish.
I will forever put Arsenal in the relegation zone. Just like my
19.
So Arsenal. Okay. Interesting.
18. Yeah.
They just
Jamal is a big Arsenal fan.
Yeah, I know. It's funny how like there's, you know, United Arsenal was more like the 2000s. Wenger and Ferguson. So I guess right around the time when we're watching,
that's like
stuff.
My time period. Yeah, like Rooney, yeah. Van Persie, like Thierry Henry. Like that's my time period.
Which right is why there, I feel like a lot of people, like, and from our generation, don't hate Liverpool as much, is because they just weren't good when we were supporting United until recently.
Liverpool wasn't a threat 10 years ago. So
they weren't.
The up and coming City, and it was Arsenal, Chelsea, United.
I hate Chelsea.
Well, you guys
love,
can go take
love some guys. Love some guys on Chelsea. Hate Chelsea.
It pained me to see Christian Pulisic in a Chelsea uniform.
Dying, maybe not for long.
Hopefully.
Oh, he's not going to United. Get out of here.
He's going to United.
I don't care if he goes as long
go
as
to
not
Bayern.
Chelsea. Yeah.
Well, I'm gonna leave. This is just.
I didn't
Chelsea
actually watch. Pop. Yeah, I don't know.
Are you a Chelsea fan, Sean?
I am.
All right, my bad. I didn't realize that while I was on the attack.
I was gonna keep it going.
Oh, this is a nonstop
onslaught.
United gets carried by Bruno. They'd be in a relegation without him.
This is true.
I mean, that's not wrong. We have some up and coming players. I mean, Pogba's hurt. You know, Pogba's a big influence. I don't think
Wags is going to love to hear this.
I don't foresee Pogba being on the team for the rest of this year or at the end of this year. But
me either, unfortunately.
You know, when you talk about selling a guy at 100 million euros and bringing in somebody, you got the potential to bring in somebody like Holland. You know, I don't, if that's possible, I don't know. But, you know, you have money to fill the void.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Especially if he's, you know, if his mind's checked out. So we'll see.
He's
on
a great player. Bendable.
I would actually agree with that.
At this point.
I would agree with that. Especially if we can bring in some. I mean, we need a number nine. We need another holding mid, I think. We need a center back. So.
And Martial can take a hug, too.
I'll tell you what we don't need is a left back, baby, because Luke Shaw is here to stay.
Thick boy.
My man is looking thick, and he's looking good.
Alex Telles was going to be our starter, but.
Me, too. But, it's a noticeable drop-off. Yeah.
For sure.
All right. So do you know the last line, Dan? It's make your own path, okay?
Make your own path. Okay.
Right. Okay.
So here we go. So until next time.
Keep learning.
You messed it up.
I messed it up.
Oh, my God. This guy messes it up. This is like the 50th episode.
Okay, run it back. Okay,
hey,
run it back.
Do you know your lines?
No,
I was
sorted.
Concerned about mine.
Okay, now we're there. I'm getting mixed up because last time I was third, this time I'm second. I don't know what's going on anymore. I'm good. I got it.
All right, take two. Until next time.
Keep moving forward.
Keep learning.
And make your own path.
There it is.
Love it.
Appreciate it.
Love
Dan.
It.
Footwork is sponsored by ourselves, but also Kong Fitness and Merchant Designs, baby. Follow us on Instagram at footwork_podcast. Twitter is @footwork_podcast. YouTube and Facebook. Just check out Footwork Podcast. Search it. Email us if you need anything, any questions at footworkpodcast@gmail.com. And remember, plug, plug, pass. Tell your parents, Amazon delivery guy, mailman, I don't know who, just tell them. Like, subscribe, review, all of it helps. Danke.